So preparation actually for this year, because we had to get our hands on a CRF110 for the giveaway. CRF110s are a hot commodity and they're not very easy to get. Thursday, a Creative 2 finally came in. Boom, we're in business. John put them together really fast. Got everything all put together, got our banners, got our tickets, got our trailer loaded up Friday night, got it parked. So this way when we woke up, first thing Saturday morning, I woke up at 5 and I'm not a really riser, to get here by 5:45 and get it on the road. So we all show up at the dealership Saturday morning, 5:45, met Scott, got hooked up, we were rolling out to Unadilla. Had to stop the fast track, grab some snacks for the ride out there, and about an hour and 45 minutes. Finally, we get there, pull in, talk to our Honda sales rep, Masi. Points us out, tells us everywhere that we need to go, get parked. Parking was super easy. Luckily, they were expecting us, so they were able to push us right in. We got our bikes unloaded, set up over at the Honda HRC tent. Then we were kind of rushing a little bit because the wheel call line was very long. Didn't go quick. And got signed in, everything was super smooth. By the time we were set up over back with Honda HRC, got our tent up, got our bikes out, got all of our cards out, and people were already lining up pretty quickly.
Make sure you fill out for our 110 raffle too if you haven't already. Oh, we're gonna put them right inside of this box right here. Yes, ma'am.
We thought we were on top of it. We knew how busy it was gonna be. We created a QR code on a business card that people were just gonna be able to scan and enter in. Naturally, it didn't work, but we were expecting it not to work. So on the back side of it, we allowed people to just fill out their information, their number. We're gonna go ahead and send everybody a text message, make sure that we do get entered in the correct way. So all 1,000 of you that did fill out those cards, you're gonna get entered in, don't worry. What's really cool about this entire experience is being able to see behind the scenes what these guys go through day in and day out. As just race fans, all that we see is the 2 30-minute plus two motos that they're putting out down on the track, but a lot of people don't realize that those mechanics are there first thing in the morning. They're getting bikes prepped, they're getting bikes clean. These guys are going out for practice, for time qualifying. We see all of that. They don't sit down there. It is a true business what they're doing at each one of these here races, and the amount of effort that goes into it is incredible. You know, we were asked to be there, but then in a second sense too, we're making sure that we're not getting in the way. You know, we're huddled into one area, but these guys are moving. You know, it is very dialed. All the way down to lunch, they put on a huge spread for us for lunch, and not just us, but each and every single race for the families and this huge entire team. What is really cool though, when it comes down to the riders, Chance Hymas, Jo Shimoda, Hunter Lawrence, Fortune Jet wasn't there this week, is even though they have such a packed schedule, they're taking the time there to do their autograph sessions. They took the time to come up to us and shake our hands, and you know they're prepping, they're staying warm, they're hydrating, and they're getting in their calories in the way that they need to. These dudes just all have a smile on their face the whole time, even though it's got to be so stressful for them to think about an incredible track like Unadilla too. You know, I mean, it got rough, and unfortunately, Chance did go down in that first moto there, but nonetheless, they weren't too busy to talk to their fans and thank everybody for coming out too. You know, they love being there. It's really cool. So after they fed us lunch, Lars Lindstrom, even though he's busy as all heck, he took the time out to give us a rig tour, which is something that not a lot of people see.
This truck is the tech truck, you know, everything with the bike and the mechanics and everything like that. This is their truck. That truck is hospitality, so riders, lounge, all the food. That's where we do all the video. The ghosting, if we could do that in Supercross and things like that, and then a little bit more hanging out over there. But like I said, that truck's a lot more boring than this truck, so we're going here. We'll probably go inside first, and then we'll come out. Come on in.
Good.
This is Shane Drew.
How are you?
Shane Drew and I worked together for like 20 plus years.
Feels like 30, 40, I don't know.
Yeah, Shane is in charge of chassis development and all kinds of stuff actually, but the main thing is chassis and testing and things like that. But yeah, this truck anyways is, this whole pop out right here is nice for the extra room because during the week or even tomorrow? Yeah, they'll build tomorrow here in this truck. So they'll take the bike, wash it, pull the plastic off, things that are gonna get replaced are gone. And then it gets taken apart and worked on right here. And they take the parts and they lay them all out. They use a solvent tank right here and they'll have these strainers and things. Each guy's kind of got their own, you know, their own method and their own way that they do things as a mechanic. And Shane was a mechanic too, taught me a lot of stuff. And same old story, been doing it forever. But yeah, he pulled the bike all the way apart, clean everything, either with soap and water outside and scrub it up and look for any cracks or anything that could be broken or bent or whatever, and then make it look pretty at the same time, and then lay it all out, take the grease off with the solvent, and then you start putting it back together, and basically in that same day it comes apart, and it's all put together at the same day.
Usually about a 10 or 12 hour shift to get it done.
Yep.
So what is it? Mechanic, most seniority gets the pop-out area right here?
Yeah, I don't know how they've got to figure it out right now. When Jet's racing, Jet's here.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure if that's just because he's got the most championships or if it's because they've worked out a deal. But I think sometimes there's been a little bit of like the guy that had the best result from the week before, he might get here. Or the guy in the better spot in the championship, he gets to be here.
Or the guy who wakes up earliest on work day.
Yeah, or maybe just the mechanic with the most seniority on the team, maybe, yeah.
Just like, you know, the closest parking spot at work, right?
Yeah, yeah, exactly, yeah. But basically all these drawers right here are kind of ready to go with all kinds of different things, electrical parts and things like that. And then, 450 suspension, and then 250 suspension below, so pretty sweet. Yep. And then when you're building the bike, they'd rather build the bike in the truck rather than at the shop because everything is just right here. So if you need something, it's all these production parts or all the, you know, rubber grommets and brake bushings and things like that. They're ready to go. Easy, quick grab. And then you can just make a note. It's quick and easy. Same with controls. This is a obligatory foot peg show off session. So, but those foot pegs are, you know, machined out of a one block of titanium and to the shape that we need them. And for one, they're super light. And two, they're super strong. Yeah, and they're also the shape. This is a little different shape. These are like -5 back from production. These ones are. So we have a couple different. I mean, the rider can kind of tailor the bike to the way he wants it. And this is one of the things that they can do. Yeah, these are actually kind of cool because that tie foot peg spring, other than being light, it's super stiff. Like, so when you.
I was just about to say that's very stiff.
Yeah. And when it snaps back, it cleans out a lot quicker and easier. It doesn't sack out like a production spring or steel spring. And then the bracket to go with it too, which is kind of nothing really special about the bracket other than it's light in it, but it has to go with these foot pegs. It's different than production. So grips, handlebars all ready to go with the grip already glued on, and then sprocket drawer with options for sprockets and discs. And then this weekend, because of the mud too, it's like hard to.
A lot of mud prep.
Yeah, mud prep, and then trying to keep everything clean. And but yeah, if we have any crashes or anything like that, we'll
strip our clamps
ready. And everything's been prepped,
different,
you know, by the mechanics.
Different,
yeah. So. Yeah. It kind of, the more you go down, it's less stuff that you don't really use that much, like the, you know, bolts and things like that. But all these, that's one thing about our titanium is actually really, really high quality from Japan, that stuff. And we're lucky about that. I think, to me, the most amazing thing is the quality, like the craftsmanship of the machining. It's like everything is, there's no sharp edges, you know, it's all been perfect. It's... You get a lot of like aftermarket companies that make it, and there's always something a little different. These are always perfect, so it is pretty cool. And then Yeah. The more you go down, it's just, you know, the different parts of the bike, fuel injection, chain guide and sliders and things like that. But more this direction, here's where the second guy would work. So this is his solvent tank, and then he works here a little bit tighter. But the more towards the back there, as you can see, this is our Showa area, where our Showa techs. That's the big boss in the back.
This is where the magic happens back here, right?
Yeah. Hopefully not too much magic on the weekends. Hopefully we're good to go and we don't have to make too many changes. But if we do, like this weekend, we're, you know, with the 2025 450. So Derek is the 450 tech. He's been with the Lawrences for a long time and super good relationship with them. And they've had a ton of success. So he's, you know, working overtime today, trying to make sure that we're all good.
Make sure she's running good, right? Good.
Yeah, yeah. But so for the most time, most of the time, we don't have to do a lot of rebuild or working on settings and everything. Maybe rebuilding here and there, but they're all prepared. But usually it's taking the notes, making sure we got all that taken down so we know. And one thing that's kind of cool, I'm going to jump in here, is our engines right here with, let's do that. 450 engines here, 250 engines here, but these things are ready to go. So you can just, boom, pull out, got oil in them, everything's good. But hopefully we don't use those during the race day either, so. Pretty sure it was wood under there. And then the rest is like the pressure washers are back here that lead to the outside, things like that. And then the rest of the cabinets just have other ancillary parts, whatever that we need, air filters, like that, you know, skid plate foam and things like that, sandpaper, SOS pads, rubber gloves, all that kind of stuff fits well in those drawers. So that's where they go. Yeah, some of the beakers and things like that, engine oil. And then we'll go up and check this out real quick. Coming in.
Come on in.
This is the control center, basically. This is Hutch. Hutch is the 450 crew chief. So.
What's up, guys?
How you doing?
You guys, come on up.
Yeah, come on in. He's kind of got a, obviously, like just like Derek, he's got the task of making sure that the 2025 doesn't, you know, embarrass us today.
What's up, brother?
No pressure.
Yeah.
Good, good.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah.
So he's got squiggly lines up there. And that's fine to look at. I don't think there's anything that you can't see, but if you can decipher that, we'll hire you. But but basically, he's got all the data from the last session, I'm sure, and looking at just the way the bike runs and make sure that there's, for one, no issues, and, you know, the bike's running properly, and then you know, air fuel and things like that. And, you know, maybe some of the starts that they did, the practice starts, where, you know, we got a new bike. So we got to make sure that we've had like the best starting motorcycle now for a long time. And the new bike, you know, there's no guarantee that the new bike's going to be as good as that. We have to make sure it is. But
how long's Hunter been riding the 450?
The new one?
Yeah.
He's a really.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, he's ridden the production version.
Right.
Here and there, dabbled at it.
Yeah, because there's a few parts that we needed and things like that. And then really after Washougal, we didn't have a plan, like this is what we're doing, until after Washougal. Then it really got, rode the production bike more after the 450 intro. And he was so pumped on it that they wanted to ride it really bad, and we did too. We just didn't have enough parts and things to make sure that we could do it properly. But those things came in, and like Hutch and Shane and our parts guy Todd and some of those guys, you know, worked hard to get it here in time. And our HRC liaison Toru, making sure that all those things can happen. And then so we got it all, and so far Hutch went down and went testing with them, and so far, I mean, everything looks really, really promising. So we'll see how it goes. But other than that, we 250 crew chief sits here, and then Shane sits here, and then we email to Japan if we have to, and go over things like that, and then make the decisions on what's going on with the bike for the next race or moto or practice or things like that. So that's basically what happens in here. And then up here is more parts, bigger parts like the bodywork, plastic and all that, and then the mechanics have their spares and things like that. They basically have everything prepped, you know, like we damage a swing arm or something, they have a swing arm that's already been prepped, and it's not brand new, where you need to put grease in and all that. Like, yeah, it's ready to go. And then inventory, the mechanics will do the inventory in the truck as they work, but sometimes they don't do a good enough job.
Yeah.
And then we run out of stuff all of a sudden. But they, when they're building, they're always looking, you know, like when they start getting low on something, or even if, you know, whatever, how many parts they take, we have a list going, and then they write that list down at the end of the weekend. They'll take that list and ship it or send it to Torrance.
Right, yeah.
And then our parts guy, Todd, will replenish stock of whatever we need. So, but yeah, sometimes we had a system where we would actually like use like a barcode scanner. It's just too time consuming because the mechanics, when you build as a mechanic, you got to be here at like 7:30 in the morning, and that's not early. That's kind of, you know, just average.
Yeah.
And then you cannot really stop all day. It's you're basically thrashing the whole day to get your bike done in time. And that's coming with like parts that are prepped, you know, like a linkage. You might have two linkages and you have one ready to go. And when you rebuild your bike, you put the new one on, it's already done. So you save that time.
Right.
And then you clean and rebuild the other linkage maybe the next Friday or you bring it back to the shop. And then some of the guys bring their brakes back and that just time consuming stuff that you save on a build day, because basically you build all day and it's a grind. And then at the end of that day, you gotta be done.
On road tech and shop tech, same thing.
Yeah, we do have a couple guys in the shop that help with testing and helping with, if we need practice bike help and things like that. But basically the race mechanic is also helping with prepping practice bikes and things like that. They might have a practice bike guy, you know, servicing at home,
right?
But he's not the one that's like building the bike and all that. He's just keeping it going and things like that. So, and then in the back there, we will keep right now the carts up there for the tent, all the awning poles and all those kind of things going that, and everything's kind of organized. You know, it's got its spot, so it all goes back the same way for the most part.
Not yet.
That's basically it. And then we can check out the bikes outside.
Qualifying.
Our 250 is all basically built in-house at American Honda, where the 450 is a way much more collaborated with Japan. So this one, we were able to use a lot of the same chassis parts and things like that because it is the same frame now. So we can use the same, you know, foot pegs and brakes and triple clamps and, you know, the whole subframe, like a lot of those things, spring arm, linkage, that all, they share the same one, which is great. And it saves us in the truck too, putting away parts, you know?
Yeah.
Like we used to, for that one year in 20, the 450 and 21 was new, and the 21 250 was still the old generation. Then you gotta have both sets of plastic,
almost,
two different types of frames, you know?
It almost looks like the neck of that one's a little different than the production model.
Which,
this one, the neck on this.
This should be the same as production. As far here?
Yeah.
No, that's the same.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah. We had the 24, the 450 we were racing had a couple of patches, but it really was the same geometry and everything like that. It just had a couple of stiffening patches. But this one's standard. The 250 didn't, they didn't like the patches on that as much for some reason, or they just got stuck in their way and they didn't want to change. So.
Right.
But as far as this one goes, like currently this whole wire harness and everything, all this right here, that's a one-off wire harness, like 100% built in at American Honda. So it's got these Autosport, the Deutsch connectors.
Yes.
And a lot more Formula One type of technology on there compared to what comes stock.
Yeah, because they double lock compared to a single lock mechanism, right?
Yeah, I think it's maybe even triple.
Yeah. I worked for Nissan
okay.
for 30 years.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of familiar with their flips and stuff. Yeah. Yeah. So.
Yeah. And they, I mean, they got
the
way
German,
more.
But the German ones are so much better than.
Yeah, the Deutsch connector is really nice.
Yeah,
and they're you're able to, you know, unclip and clip like 100 times more than a standard
right.
Production
Teagan,
plastic
Teagan
one.
Break, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, anyways, but the main reason we do that is for durability for one, but also that the breakouts are in different spots, so we can run exactly where we want it for the race bike and. Like we could take the whole throttle body off with one clip, like things like that. There's some really cool things about it. We're also the first ones to make electric water pump here.
I was just looking at it. It's like, then why is it electric?
We took off that and then everybody copied us basically.
Is that right?
But it just, takes a little bit of drag off the engine.
Well, right, yeah. Yep. The less you take out of the engine, the
right.
as far as the mass weight of turning,
right.
you get more horsepower.
Yeah, and the mechanical impeller didn't need to spin that water, so that's a little bit of power. And then it's always pushing the coolant
right.
at constant speed, and it's a little bit, you know, the speed that we want it at.
Uniform, yeah.
yeah.
And you can control that, right?
Right, yeah. yeah. So you don't need to worry about impeller, you know, well, speeding up yeah. and with the engine RPM.
Okay.
So that was cool, and that's actually pretty cool too, because when the bike is hot, the 250s obviously get real hot. When they come in, you could run the electric water pump and then cool it while it's sitting here. You can just run water, and the whole bike cools down so fast.
See, a lot of that comes from obviously drag racing with cars. Mm-hmm. They do the same stuff. They can have a coolant tank,
yeah.
plug, and cool it down because it's on an electric pump. They can just yeah, drag the pump and let it go.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah.
And it's same with F1, right? When they come in with the fans,
exactly
and they,
right. Yeah.
They, so we have the same kind of. Concept. Some kind of thing, yeah.
yeah.
Which is, that's been really nice. This one also has a hydraulic clutch.
I see it.
This is it, yeah. And that's a really nice setup, that this whole sandcast mag
so
cover
that's,
here.
That's just a one-off too, right?
Yeah. Yep, yeah, that's factory. Which is cool, because that, like I said, Honda Japan or HRC doesn't really, they're not super involved with this bike, but that part is something they made like 6 years ago, and it's still the same.
Right.
So we're able to order that and use it, which is great. And then, but yeah, so 250, we're always working on power, and 450, we're always working on chassis. So 450 has plenty of power. We just need to, we just tune it to where they want it and make it smooth and rideable. And but we're always tuning on chassis and suspension.
And that was the big idea of the new 25, is
yeah.
the chassis change. So I noticed that the chassis change of the 25, the steering head.
Yep.
The geometry of that is such a different angle, isn't it?
Geometry is not different.
It looks like the height is though from.
It's a little bit different. I mean, you can see it right there. We'll go check it out in a little bit.
I was looking at the 25.
Oh, yeah, yeah, the production bike, yeah. In that area, they don't look that different, but the thicknesses and the stiffness and the rigidity balance.
It just looks like something's different compared to the older bike to this one.
And yeah.
I'm like, somebody changed something there. I just can't see what they did.
Yeah, it's tough to see. Like I said, a lot of it is the rigidity. The biggest difference is this right here.
Yep.
There's the subframe bracket that comes off of this big cast piece here.
Yep.
And that helps the binding of the whole frame. The torsional rigidity.
So are they just mending it here, or are they putting a support up inside that tube as well?
No, this tube is like, I don't think it's anything different, but the bracket sits off of this, which is a much stiffer piece.
Gotcha, okay.
So when the force is coming up through the frame, it's not hitting those side spars and doing this.
Yeah, twisting it.
And so stability-wise, that is a big reason why that's there. I think anything else that's cool in the 250 versus 450 might be kind of it. But yeah, tons of work. This is the Get ECU and data logger. So this thing right here will show you when you change a map or something, it'll show you which map. It also can do an RPM limit if you want it to. So on the start, you can see what RPM you should be at. It does a couple different things, and then when you have start mode on, it lets you know that you're in start mode. So there's a lot that's been really cool, especially the data logger and the data logging system.
Like when you were just looking at
right,
it there.
Right. Okay. Yep. The cool thing is that we've had it at the races for a long time, so that's not really any different. But the biggest difference is that now we have it on our practice bikes, all of them, and they're able to download them in Florida and send us the data in real time, and then we can just look at it right away and make mapping changes and things like that, and it's super helpful on 250.
Yeah.
Because you're always trying to optimize and test and make it run better. A lot of times 450, once it's running good and it's running clean, you don't make a lot of changes, but the Lawrences definitely make more changes than anybody we've ever worked with before when it comes to that, because they're kind of into it. Dad, you know, Dad Darren is super involved with the team. He's more part of the team than just a parent. And so he's like a team member, and he's smart, and he knows a lot of things. That's why they've gotten so far in their career so far. So we're always tinkering with like start modes and things like that, and it has worked really well, you know, because they've obviously not just won a lot, but their starts have gotten much, much better. So we can look at the 25 real quick. This is Cam.
What's up?
Hey, what's up? How are you?
I'm Mike. Nice to meet you,
brother. Nice to meet you.
This is Mike Spraker, by the way. Don't go anywhere.
That's your breaker?
Spraker 19 is like what we like to call him.
Spraker 19.
I drive the truck.
But basically, yeah, I mean, for the first time using this or running the 25, not a bunch of differences, but or not like it's not like a completely new motorcycle, but I mean, there are some definitely some big differences when it comes to the airbox and the whole wiring harness and system like that. It's quite a bit different. So
just badass.
Yeah.
So forks and coating is just so sick.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty nice, huh? So, but other than that, we're still kind of learning it, obviously, and doing our best with making that. We're just lucky right now because we have such a good relationship with HRC and KMO, the Kumamoto production team, that we meet with them every week and we talk to them during the week, with, you know, just not just emails, but, you know, during the weekend texting and all that stuff. And so we're able to do a lot of things with them. And we're, I don't know, are you taking a shock out?
No. We're going to put another box on.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, with the cutout, yeah. But this is kind of cool. And now, like, taking a shock out on the production Honda before is pain. And this new bike is way easier. Like, you don't have to take the subframe off, which you don't have to take the intake out. It's so much nicer. Yeah. Like, you do a couple things, you know, pipe off a couple things, and then the shock comes out the side. It's just like, especially like when your bike is for a customer, your bike's always going to be dirty under there, you know, like, you know, they're not going to clean it well enough. So when you pull the subframe off and you have to take the air boot off, you're just asking for dirt to go in there. So now that you don't even have to touch that, it's like, it's way, way nicer. So
is the track drying out? We're going to put more of an air box onto it?
Yeah, we had kind of like a mud air box that's sealed up right now. Okay. Just, you know, when we do that on a 24 or any bike, really, you know, when it starts, especially when there's a lot of standing water and splashing up, we try to seal up the air box and make sure that it just doesn't get in. So now we can go back to more of a standard one. Yeah. So yeah, that's basically it. I think we're getting ready to start going here. So
how much that Team Honda does for the riders and rider support. One thing that really impressed me was the Lawrence brothers' father. Lars touched on that a bit, how much he's involved in their racing and riding styles and how much influence they have towards gearing the bike to the racers.
We took about 30 minutes out of Lars' day. You know, even as busy as he is, he answered any questions that we had. He really diagnosed and got into these bikes. He even talked to us about what the changes are that we're going to be seeing for the 2025 motorcycles. And that's going to help us. That's going to help us sell the bike too. And you know, we're going to be able to tell our customers, hey, this is why you should ride a 25 instead of a 24. Tore everything all down at 12 o'clock, got everything loaded back up into the truck and the trailer, and the rest of the day was ours to enjoy. Got to walk around Unadilla. Weather was perfect. Good 75 degrees or so. Great racing action going on, and just got to walk around and see how beautiful Unadilla is.
I used to go back in the early days, which was really much wilder than it was today. It's calmed down quite a bit and more controllable, but also the racing experience is fantastic there. They have, to me, one of the best tracks and we have right here in our backyard, Unadilla does. And the way that they got the track prepped for the day was very impressive. We got, you know, 6 to 8 inches of rain in some areas. And yeah, the pits were muddy, but who cares? The racing surfaces was absolutely perfect. It was fast, so the guys were able to, you know, make some good lap times on there, and it was real competitive.
So, you know, of course, from everybody at Outdoor Motorsports, we really want to thank everybody from HRC Honda, Lars, for spending all that time walking through with us and going through bikes with us, and our rep, Masi, you know, for giving us the opportunity to go out there to Unadilla, and Danny Gonzalez, you know, he's a heck of a guy too. Yeah, we really appreciate everything that they did for us, and of course anybody else that we forgot, we appreciate it.